In the name of Allah, the Merciful, the Compassionate. First of all, I'd like to hail and greet the United Arab Emirates government and people, this young state that has been progressing in the field of modernization of the different sectors of life in the Arab and the Gulf region at the economic, cultural, and scientific levels and many other levels. I'd like also to hail and greet this strategic center and as a great think tank, and we are being criticized for the lack and shortage of think tanks in the Arab region, and this is this center is in fact an outstanding think tank center with its own great potentials, and the types of publications and books issued by this Emirates center will lead us to recognize this great work, and shows that we are capable of establishing think tanks and strategic centers, and we can go forward. My gratitude also goes to the audience, the generous audience that took the trouble of traveling and coming and determined to attend this lecture. And I do not have any doubt that many of you know better than me in many aspects, and therefore I thank you and humbly thank you for your attendance. I have prepared a set of ideas and points and wrote my paper on my own lecture, but in fact I do not find it useful to read something for you, because you can read it, especially that most of you and the majority are from the intellectual elite that follows matters like political Islam through the different channels of media. It has been the subject of discussions for more than 3 or 4 years, and because since the year 1970, let's say after the death of Gamal Abdel Nasser of Egypt and the Arab defeat, and the Arab world has been sunk in this trend and its own groups and political parties, including the Muslim Brotherhood, to the Salafi groups and to the Tahrir party and to the jihadists and to other parties. And thereafter, the Iranian Revolution came in 1979, and therefore this movement started to take two sects or two schools of thought, and a rich country like Iran came over with the revolutionary ideas, and then the Iraq-Iran war broke out immediately thereafter, and this motivated the atmosphere on a large scale, and then the Afghan war broke out once again, which attracted many of our own youth. And once the Iraq-Iran war came to its end and the Afghan front calmed down, Kuwait was invaded by Iraq in 1990, and the war that followed in 1991 thereafter. This created a great storm in which political Islam was a party, and during the 90s, the organizations like Al-Qaeda started to work in Africa and other places, and then they the climax reached September, you remember the September attacks to 2001, and thus political Islam was no longer an Arab issue but an international matter or question, and therefore the war on terror became part and parcel of international politics. And we do remember in the year 1989 and 1990 1990 when the Berlin Wall fell down and that the Soviet Union came to its end. And as Fukuyama predicted, that was the end of history, and that was a great change in human history. And actually, in some moments, we've thought that that was the end of the Roman Empire, in fact, because people were used to see the Soviet Union and the two blocks, the two poles fighting and in the Cold War and so on and so on. And always our fate was on the verge of catastrophe. And all of a sudden, things change. And there were great expectations that peace will prevail. And all of a sudden, things change now. Terror we have now, international dismemberment, new nationalists, and also ethnic groups. And each country consists of different ethnic groups, started to witness the emergence of a new independent, and even within one religion, they started to concentrate on sectarianism, and even the sects or the schools of thought started to enter into a kind of an inter-conflict among themselves. And this situation deserves to be studied and to be the question to be asked. What is political Islam here? The strange thing in this matter is that Islam has been throughout history has been involved with politics. And it's not like Buddhism or Hinduism or other religions, because Islam started with the establishment of a state, and therefore that was something there. I mean, politics is always there. So we are not talking about politics in Islam, but we are talking about a phenomenon that is now existing in this, in the 20th century and this century. And during this period, we had seen the emergence of political parties and organizations where religion is politicized. And this party, for example, was established. And do I say that I swear that Allah is the only God and Muhammad is the messenger of God in order to be a member? No, they have their own criteria. They have their own standards. When I joined the Muslim Brotherhood and to be a leader in this party, for example, even if you believe, if you have a different sectarian attitude, you will be set aside. If you are not a member of the Salafi group, you will be set aside. And if you are from Tahrir Square, everybody will be cautioned against you not to be contacted because you will destroy their work. And if you are from the mystics or the Sufis, you will have a problem with the Salafis, and so on and so forth. So we are facing a new phenomenon, in fact, the matter has been that the political movements or the Islamist movements that were exploited in Europe, you remember Nazism and fascism and Marxism and other movements in Europe were exploited for political purposes, and their legacy, their partisan legacy and organizational legacy were used, in fact, in building the legends or the battle fields, and also on their internal structure of the party. And thus you will have a hierarchical structure. They have the murshid, which is called the guide or mentor, and you do not enter directly into that organization. There are stages you will be accepted as you are saturated with this ideology that they feed you and with, and therefore the picture has been completely different, and it's no longer that of the city-state or the Khulafa state. No, the spontaneity of Islam and came to its end, in fact, and now you have a kind of an organized activity, political activity, for example, in a city or a state like Kuwait, for example. There are two parties for the Muslim Brotherhood, one for the Kuwaiti Muslim Brothers, and also and the Egyptian party for the Egyptian brothers. They do not have direct contact or declared contact between two parties. Each one works in parallel and separately, and they are not in they are are not responsible for each other. The Egyptian Muslim brothers are in contact with their Cairo-based or Egypt-based leaders, and the Kuwaitis are dealing with their leaders in Kuwait, and so on and so forth. The same thing applies to the Salafis, and the I don't know exactly, the Tahrir party is also a party that was established in 1952 or 53. They had a problem with the Jordanian authorities at that time to be licensed, and they considered the Muslim Brotherhood as dervishes and dervishes, and they do not know anything about politics, and they needed more a stricter discipline, and they concentrated on the idea of caliphdom and to revive the idea of the caliph state. And this will take us to another subject, which is known for the those researchers of political Islam. They have a complicated problem with the state, the national state in the Arab countries, and they have their own perspective of the Ummah Islamiyah, of huge slogans of the Islamic nation, and this was derived from the literature of the beginnings of the 20th century, especially in Europe between the two wars, the German nation and the Italian nation. You remember these ideas, and they have these conceptions.
Therefore, one now and prior to try to know the characteristics and features of the political Islam, at least we can look at it. These features and characteristics depend on partisan movements and activity and ideology. Religion has changed into ideology, and no one used to focus on Islamism and Islamist. It is well known that Islam was built on five pillars, but there is Islamic food, there is Islamic cinema, and Islam is being now introduced in every issue without any justification. And now we have the Islamic literature. We know that there is the Islamic literature. There are books, and writers have booked since the days of Hassan ibn Thabit, the early poet, and other writers and authors. But now there is this Islamic literature that mobilizes the followers, and it is a literature built on the pillars made by Muhammad, by Qutb, and by Hassan al-Banna, and they began to deal with culture and arts in general. What the issues that attract the attention is that one would wonder when and why has the political Islam started. Usually when we read about this issue and on this issue, they would say it started with Jamal al-Din al-Afghani, Muhammad Abdu, and Rashid al-Rifai. But I refer the start of the issue to the deterioration of the Osmanic state, which extended to Europe and was about to grab and occupy and the Balkan states and Austria, and it extended to Russia and other parts of Europe, and the Osmanic state began to fall and to lose positions. Europe, which used to be weak and unable to face the Osmanite armies and other divisions, and the Turks were known to be brave and tough in wars. But there were internal factors in the Osmanite state, and the Inkishari forces lost their ability to fight. Moreover, they also ignored the European progress in the scientific progress, and they began to ignore that. However, made them aware, became aware, was when Napoleon occupied Egypt. They began to ask, how can these Europeans come and occupy a part of the Islamic world? So, and the colonialism reached Indonesia with the Dutch, and Russians began to move towards the Black Sea and towards Iran and to take parts of it, as well as Central Asia. The British as well took India, they occupied India, and there was a struggle between the British and the French on Egypt. So there was that struggle, and what to do in order to confront that serious risk that threatens their existence. Then ideas began to emerge. The Osmanite state tried to confront that risk by making some different reforms, by passing certain legislations, cultural and educational legislations. But the students who were sent to Europe to study in the 19th century began to get affected by the European life in France when they used to see the parliaments and the national movements and press. So when they would return back to Istanbul, they used to face troubles. So Sultan Abdul Hamid was compelled to issue the Turkish and Osmanite constitution, but he could not finish it, and the war started against modernity from that time. And the saying that Quran was our constitution began at that time. And people would say, we do not want laws. And one of those thinkers was Jamaluddin al-Afghani in Istanbul at that time. Jamaluddin al-Afghani and there was different sayings and statements about him, whether he was Iranian, whether he was a Masonite member. Many discussions and ideas were said about him, and we don't have time to go into details. But one of the most significant aspects of Jamaluddin Afghani was that he said he did not resort to the Sanusi school or Sheikh Mohammed bin Abdul Wahhab school by focusing on purifying the creed and belief, but he stated that since the Europeans were advanced, we should learn their culture and we should Islamize it, and by that way we can progress and solve our problems. That idea was taken by Sheikh Muhammad Abdu, the late Sheikh Muhammad Abdu. Who tried to make reforms in Al-Azhar and in the public life. The two of them published Al-Urwa Al-Wuthqa magazine in Paris, and they used to publish it in the Islamic world. But Sheikh Muhammad Abdu, in spite of his reforms and the importance of his reforms, was not able to make the required progress in the Arab life. First of all, because Sheikh Mohammed Abdu did not develop his ideas to their utmost, and it was not enough and sufficient to say no need for secularism. And you have to take the results at the end of the road, because there are steps that should be taken, and that you have to have the answers for the modern Muslims who would pose questions. So Sheikh Mohammed Abdu did not succeed in in making such answers ready for modern Muslims. The other thing is that the European progress took place fastly and more fast than the ability of the Islamic nation and Islamic world to follow. And that made Sheikh Muhammad Abdu and the others unable to follow that progress. When Sheikh Muhammad Abdu died, his student who followed his step and was Sheikh Muhammad Rashid Rida. Muhammad Rashid Rida was less than, he was not in contact with the West, unlike Muhammad Abdu and Jamaluddin al-Afghani. And he was following the Hanbali school. He was from Syria, and there were many Hanbalis in Syria. So he was less in understanding the other religions, especially Christianity. And as we know, there was the conflict, the Islamic Christian conflict in Al-Sham area. And it was different than the struggle and the conflict in Egypt. So Rashid Rida began to adopt the Salafi school, and he began to develop his relationships with the founder of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia and the Salafi founder. And the result was that the young people did not find the leader who could solve the problem of integration in the modern society and life. Therefore, we began to see the Arab intellectuals were divided into two camps. One group began to have no interest, and the other began to adopt liberalism and other modern schools. At that time, there were the religious societies, among which was the Muslim Brothers Association in 1928. And there started the political Islam to emerge. And people who followed the religious way to adopt a mass work and to interfere in modern movements and issues, that led to the political Islam. And from that point, the movement got along. Hassan al-Banna, this is an important point. Hassan al-Banna was not an Islamic intellectual. He has not studied or researched. He was a man for mass activity and of movement, and he was a man to move among Muslims and to act among them. And he was aiming at making an organization. Whether he was affected by the Marxists and the Mr. Al-Fatah in Egypt and the other organizations, he might have been affected as well by the fall of the Caliphate state in Turkey. And from that, the idea moved ahead. I am trying I'm trying to focus on the important and significant points. I have some points on the development of the political Islam between 1928. The 20 years from 28 to 48 was the time that witnessed the establishment of the Muslim Brotherhood prior to the assassination of Hassan al-Banna in 1949. That the second phase was that extended up to 1970, and among the most significant events after the assassination of the leader of the Brotherhood movement, there was a wide discussion, and the Egyptian revolution took place, and the Muslim Brothers said that they contributed to the Egyptian revolution, and there was the conflict between Abdel Nasser and the Muslim Brotherhood, and the Muslim Brothers were isolated, and that situation continued up to 1967, when the defeat of June 6th, and until 1970, when President Abdel Nasser died, and the third phase of the political Islam started. That stage was the Sadat time. Sadat had conflicts with his competitors and rivals, and he was not the heir of the Egyptian revolution, and he allowed the religious current to act and to be active in life. And we know that that stage ended with the assassination of Sadat and the start of Hosni Mubarak's stage. With President Hosni Mubarak, a new stage began, and the Muslim Brothers began to be active again and to be parliament members, and that continued up to 2011, when the Arab Spring started, and from that Arab Spring start, a fourth stage started. Now, where is the Islamic world heading with the political Islam? Is the political Islam capable of providing solutions to the existing problems? This is a major challenge we are witnessing. This current and this movement, there is a huge Arab crisis we are witnessing as a result of underdevelopment and the weak infrastructure due to the weak and the fragmentation. But what is the solution from all these crises? And how can we solve this dilemma, and how can we contribute to solve this dilemma? I don't want to take your time. I want to listen to some questions, and through these questions and comments, we can discuss, and we can come out with a vision, because lots of aspects of this Arab situation are, we don't have direct answers and quick answers for these questions. The current situation in Syria or in Yemen or in North Africa, in Libya, in other countries? How can we come out of such situations? Some of these countries witness some of the political Islamic activity as if we have no experience. People start from the trash, and people do not benefit from the accumulated experiences and the bitter experiences witnessed in the Arab world. Once again, we go back to the early beginnings, and this is one of the major problems. In the Arab reality, about which we should think deeply, and I stop here temporarily, and I want to see what we can get from you. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mr. Khalil Ali Haidar, for this valuable presentation and the important information about political Islam and its development and history and the stages of its own development and characteristics thereof. And you asked the question, is political Islam capable of providing solutions to the Arab world and Islamic world? And I think this is the question that imposes itself upon all of us. And now we may open the floor for you. Please, Mr. Khalil Ali Haidar, do you like to come here? Yes. Please, those who'd like to ask questions, please introduce yourselves and then make your questions direct and clear and brief, please. We start with you, Dr. Abdurrahman. And your friend, Dr. Khalil, is your friend, isn't he? Thank you very much. In the name of Allah, Abdul Rida Asiri, University of Kuwait. Listening to you, Mr. Haidar, gives us an analytical and objective and neutral analysis of political Islam. I have some inquiries. Today you wrote about the concept of freedom in political Islam, and I hoped that you would tackle this point. What is the relationship here that we see, for example, in political Islam? How do they see the concept of freedom? This is my first inquiry or first question. Mr. Khalil, political Islam is now a tool in the hands of the regimes. There is an opposition political Islam and also a political Islam movement which is supporting the regimes. Does this differ from that, or do we have two forms? When you are in power, you are different from being in a position. And the third point is that we see that we are now re-experiencing the Muslim Brotherhood experience in the Arab world. You started talking about it in Egypt in the 20s and 30s and 60s and 70s and 80s. Are we now on the verge of recreating another Ikhwani or Muslim Brotherhood experience in the other Arab countries? And I'd like to thank you for your lecture, and thank you for the ECSSR for organizing such interesting lectures. We are proud of it, and you have it, and this is a source of pride. Thank you very much indeed. He asked about the concept of freedom in political Islam. This issue of freedom is so complicated that political Islam was based on the idea of canceling these concepts and re-establishing a new system to what extent this system will be successful in adopting these insights. When you read, for example, Sayyid Qutb's book, Features on the Path, all these concepts are considered pre-Islamic or Jahiliyyah, and we need to change these books and textbooks and even Islamic books, that are considered pre-Islamic or Jahiliyyah or non-Islamic, in fact, not according to his own conception of Islam, of course. And the major problem with Mr. Sayyid Qutb and other Islamists and the followers of this current is that they were influenced by Ali al-Mawludi, the Pakistani thinker, Abu Ali al-Mawludi, who was the founder of the Jamaat Islamiyah in Pakistan, who wrote about the division between Islam and Hinduism, and the background is completely different here. And here, people in Egypt are Muslims, and Islam does not have or impose the same requirements that Sayyid Qutb imposed upon Muslims. And Islam accepted many things, many things from other religions. If you go back to the history of Islam, you know very well, for example, that the Prophet Muhammad, praise be upon him, found certain things in the Arab tribes, and he accepted them and he approved them. He didn't talk about the sources of these traditions and saying that these are pre-Islamic, but he accepted them, and that's all. This is a very good indication that the type of the purity that they sought in religion, that Sayyid Qutb, or the founder of Muslim Brotherhood, or he puts as his own condition on that point, in order to define Islam, was so exaggerated and overstated and inaccurate, and he imposes something that he wishes, a kind of wishful thought which does not depend on research or historical research. This is a very important point. And then the other question was that the Islamic movements are tools in the hands of the regimes or governments. And but how do you mean? How do you mean? I didn't understand the question. Sometimes you find that these Islamist forces stand in opposition to the state, and sometimes they take part with the state or take sides with the state. And of course, we have to agree on something in Islam, that the Holy Quran could be interpreted in different ways, and you can interpret the verses in different ways. And the Muslim Brotherhood, for example, Muslim Brothers adopted two interpretation of this economic approach in Islam. Dr. Mustafa Sibai, for example, of the Syrian Muslim Brotherhood, wrote a book in which he put accurately 1959 about the socialism in Islam, and he says that socialism is an approach in Islam and something existing in Islam, and you cannot cancel it. And while during the same stage during which Jamal Abdel Nasser adopted socialism in Egypt, the Muslim brothers entered into a very bloody conflict against socialism or the socialist approach that he ratified or adopted. And also Mustafa Sibai's book is available. You can have a look. And of course, the Muslim Brothers do not like to see it reprinted, but it's available there. And those Muslim Brothers in Egypt said was also documented. And so they wanted to subject Islam to political strifes, and according to the regime and with whom they are fighting and conflicting, and what was their values or their own objectives, that will affect their own decisions and attitudes. The third question was about are we repeating the experience of Muslim Brotherhood and the other? Can you repeat the question, please? Use the microphone, please.
Yeah.
the historical challenges faced by the Muslim brothers during the 20s, the 40s, 60s, 70s, 80s of the last century. We are now in the 21st century. How do you see Muslim Brotherhood facing these things? Are they going to take the same challenges, same conflicts with the governments or with the nations themselves, with the peoples? I see that the Muslim Brothers were given a very rare opportunity after the Egyptian revolution in Egypt, but they lost this opportunity. The first mistake they committed is that they accepted the idea of getting involved in power, a country like Egypt with endless problems. Why do you take the venture to receive power after such a huge revolution? What forces you to take power and to accept the idea? I think they should have stayed aside, and they say, no, we should also call for social coherence and integration, and that Egypt's responsibility is to be shared by all, it's not only our own work, and we call for shared and common work, something like that. But they took power directly, and if they had taken that approach and let others take power, because all the complaints and all the things that would happen in Egypt would be in their own favor, and they would have made benefit or advantaged of all the mistakes committed by the post-revolution regimes. When will they move away so that the Muslim Brothers would take over, so they would have such a favorable scenario? But they made a big mistake. They hurried up and they were in a haste, and they took power in the midst of turmoils and upheavals, huge upheavals and differences in the Egyptian street. And Egypt has so many problems, a country that has just emerged from years and decades of dictatorship since 1952, huge problems. Moving to the age of freedom was something great, something that requires a kind of response and integration, and it was expected that mistakes could be committed and some upheavals might happen. Why did you take power? The other point is that the period during which they ruled Egypt did not reflect any experience of a political organization of 80 or 85 years old. How do you commit such silly mistakes, and why do you want to exclude others and to make the Muslim Brothers dominate the judicial system in Egypt? Why did you want the Muslim Brothers to appoint the mayors in villages of Egypt or Umda to be from your leadership? Why did you interfere in the minute details of life? They didn't show any sorts of flexibility. If you tell the Sisi, do you think that we are going to rule Egypt for 500 years, imagine, and regardless of whether this statement was true or not, I think they came with the mentality that we are the only organized party, a strong party in the political arena in Egypt. Yes, it's true. Yes, they have a long history and they have no rivals in this field, but politically speaking, they made great mistakes and they failed to solve the problem of duality in using power. President Morsi was there as a president in power, while the Murshid or the guide was there behind him, directing him as if we were in Iran, as if we have the general guide, or where we have the general guide, Sayyid Ali Khamenei, and the president of the republic. This is not fit for a modern state. There is an elected president who is responsible towards the people and for the people, and this is the constitution, what this constitution stipulates. This is the problem. This is the mistake. Please, doctor. Microphone, please. I'd like to thank Mr. Khalil Haidar for his interesting review of the history of the political Islam in the region, and I personally may agree with you that the fall or the decline of the Ottoman Empire was not certain of it as a factor, because since then, up to the 70s, for those people who, I mean, the religious persons, Muhammad Abdu or even Sayyid Qutb of Egypt, showed some signs of individual attempts to get involved in political life in their own respective countries, but in fact, they were not having that great impact, because there are other political powers that attracted wide masses of the people, the liberal movements, the socialist movements, Nasseri movements, up to the 70s of the last century. What attracts our attention, whether you agree with me or not, Mr. Khalil Haidar, is that with the beginning of the 70s, we have seen a great transformation in the Arab world. For example, you see the individual behavior changed even, and you may see some sort of the idea of hijab, for example, using the hijab. That was something new in the Arab countries, which started in the early 70s. Before that, women were not like that. They were very open to modern civilization. And what attracts your attention in the history of political Islam started with the 70s of the last century, and with the influence of the Iranian Revolution that played a great role in this, that was accompanied, as you remember, by the end of the 70s with these movements. And I think that what we witness nowadays represents a great political dilemma for the Arab societies, how to deal with political Islam. You see the trend now, for example, in great countries or important countries like Egypt, for example, there is a kind of very strong reaction against political Islam, or the experience of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt after taking power in Egypt. And I think that the trend nowadays is that showing that this strong reaction, which might represent a dilemma for the Arab nations in general, how to reconcile between this strong reaction based on a failing experience of the Muslim brothers in Egypt, and how can we reconcile it with a wide category of the Arab communities who are Muslims and devotees and devoted Muslims. My question here to Mr. Haidar, in the light of these facts, do you think that we may find a solution for these dilemmas? Is that we may try to persuade the committees to separate religion from politics? Is it possible or is it impossible? Is it possible, for example, if there is an attempt, just an attempt, that religion is there, and the Arabs and Muslims can practice their own worship, and they can worship God? Our grandfathers moved on that up to this moment. But as you said in your last statement, that the modern state, the modern national state, contemporary state, cannot accept the idea of ruling itself by a religious background. Do you think that this idea, the idea of separating politics and religion, do you think it will be a solution to this or an outlet from this dilemma? Thank you very much indeed. This, in fact, is the problem of Arab liberalism and the problem of contemporary Arab thought. And there was a huge setback even before 1967, the separation between Egypt and Syria, and the failure of the unity, and the failure of the pan-Arabism parties or the nationalist parties that failed also to achieve their own ambitions or the ambitions of the Arab masses, and the failure to solve the Palestinian issue. And that was that reached its climax in the bitter defeat of the Arab armies in 1967, that changed all concepts in the Arab world. And one of the problems that we may deal with is the Arab culture itself, that this culture has failed to develop some concepts or visions that would parallel the religious visions. And religion has its own place in all cultures and has a vital role in all communities, and people do not want their doctrines and creeds to be touched and to be to go, okay, fine, but you need new regulations, you need new life, new system, and you need development and growth and new positions. And okay, how can we develop such systems and such ideas? Liberalism may be now controversial in the Arab countries, and just before arriving here, just a few days before arriving here, I wrote an article on democracy in the Arab world, because now there are many articles and essays and research on democracy, and saying that democracy is not fit for the Arab region, and that democracy will not solve our problems. Okay, fine, fine. Indirectly, you say that democracy is fit for Israel and fit for the Indians and the Hindu, but not for the Arabs and Muslims. This is, or is it fit or not fit? If you say it's unfit, okay, this is the end. Fine, which means that the Arab Spring should have another path. If it is fit, let's do something. What should we do? What disturbs us in this kind of democracy, and how can we deal with it? Democracy is not one approach for all, is not one size for all problems. Let's see the Asians. How did they deal with it? How did the Europeans deal with these problems? And of course, not all democratic nations that adopted democracy, even in Europe after the collapse of the Soviet Union, presented successful models. No, of course not. Some of them failed and retreated completely. And now, but the problem is that we do not have, or we have not exerted an effort in this field. We have been thinking always in accepting the idea of the comprehensive or totalitarian approaches, a desire to solve the problem at the hands of one person. As the proverb says, put it on the neck of a scholar and get safe and intact. So there is no desire to take responsibility by people. And even if you say that most of the Egyptians tend to vote for Sisi, the field marshal Sisi, because many Egyptians say that Egypt should be ruled by a strong Egyptian military man, and this means that the 25th of January revolution and the 30th of July revolution came to reconsider the Egyptian will and the mentality of the Egyptian people, because the Egyptians are contributing to the modernization of their nation, their country, and not to become a burden on his own or her own country. But now we are moving in another path that would lead us to the fact that the Egyptian state that pays for education, pays for health, for support or good subsidies for food, for bread, and then you go back to the zero point, and most of your funds will go for the consumer economy, and therefore you cannot invest. And if you follow the models of free market or the Asian models, of course, they cannot help you in solving your problems by providing subsidies to the minimum details of daily life. And therefore, I think that we need a discussion and a debate in the field of Arab politics, and which has not started yet. And people are either with or against the revolution in their own writings. And the Muslim brothers are also lost themselves. They are lost. In fact, they don't have any alternative. The Egyptian street cannot accept Morsi again. And at the same time, they do not have an alternative or a substitute for that. This is part of my answer. The question is bigger than that, isn't it?
Good evening. Maask Asasi from the Emirates Strategic Center. Thank you, Mr. Khalil, for the introduction on the historical review of the political Islam. I have a question. Do we agree with the name political Islam? Has Islam been there to be political, or is there another radical Islam? This is an important point to be looked at and to depend on in order to review such thought of such groups. The second point is that we have to look at present to the mechanism on which the religious movements have depended in mobilizing and recruiting the Arab youth to be obsessed in a sort of obsession, and how can we put this in the framework of the Arab the other revolutions and movements. I will try to answer the second question. We are, and I state that we are in need to say that it is not sufficient to resort to security measures and political measures to deal with the religious current and movement. This religious movement is posing cultural and modern challenges. I give examples in my writings on the charity and the charity work. Why a region like the GCC, with all it is wealth and potentials, why would the philanthropic work be a victim of the in the hands of the religious movements? Why can't we have huge organizations like the European organization with new and scientific concepts to study and to require to give aid? We should not require people to be Muslims to be aided when there is an earthquake in Pakistan or any other crisis in Indonesia. The world would not say these are Muslims and we should not care for them. And there are new concepts now through which they move. We are in need, in the light of globalization and all these open eyes which count every move in the Arab world, we are in need to study this charity work. We have billions of dinars, dirhams, and other currencies through which we can establish a huge organization that can be found from the interest of its investments without depositing billions of dinars or dollars in this organization. And such organization could be ready to confront and to face such crises and dilemmas. On the other levels, the Arab political thinking and is not that mature to deal with the Arab reality to the extent of studying such problems and look, if we till now, I'll give you an example from Kuwait. The religious movement was against the presence of women inside the parliament, and after the pressure of the government and the woman got her right to elect and to be elected, the Muslims changed 180 degrees and they began to the presence of women in the parliament. The surprise was that all women started to vote for Islamists. How can we interpret this? This means that we have a problem in our political thinking, and our they have not said that these forces are against the rights of women, and we should teach them a lesson at least in one election session. Directly, the same people opposing women, their introduction of women in the parliament were elected again. So this is one of the problems in the Arab world at present. As for the definition of the political Islam, there are so many divisions. There is the extremism and fundamentalism, and for each political phenomenon, it is difficult to give a comprehensive definition. I remember that I read a lot about defining the nationalism, and you all know and you have read about this issue. You find various experiences. There is a nationalism in the Balkan area and the French school. The British are looking in a different way as an unnecessary matter. The Americans, they have their own definition of nationalism, and the Indians and Arabs have their own definitions of nationalism. So people with the same background and language and who are related to each other. And so what is the right definition? It is also, this is applied on the political Islam, and the Arab thought is concerned with defining and developing of visions and criticizing of and to know what is within this definition or outside the definition. This requires time to be mature, and I think there are gaps, and sometimes there are names, definitions given to certain phenomena which are not scientific. You have spoken about organization, and there is the UAE Red Crescent organization which is carrying out lots of work and charity activities all over the world, and it has lots of projects at the time of crisis. Allow me to explain this point. I don't say there are no such efforts. I think the GCC are providing lots of aids and helps, but we are in need of establishing huge organizations, and the issue and the matter should not be of financing preachers or digging of wells, but we need huge studied organizations, and the UAE, Kuwait, or Saudi Arabia provide billions of dollars in aid. But the problem is that, and up to date, they don't find the channel or the framework in which we can provide such aids, and there we have gaps which are exploited and used by some people and some parties. I am against the monopoly of the state by the state on every activities. We have the potentials, and we can organize such potentials and can be effective worldwide and could be beneficial for our humanitarian progress and march and our role in the world. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, I am Dr. Bilal Al-Sakana from the Police College. If we look at the history, and if we link the political Islam to the modern times, and if we look at the charity societies from which they move to the political Islam, and if we are to continue to link the political Islam with Egypt, there are are successful experience. I am not with Erdogan, but Erdogan came through democratic work and elections and has led a successful experience. This is a successful Islamic experience. And we in the Arab countries, unfortunately, in some examples and models, when these elections and when the if we call such parties, political parties related to the to religion and Islam as an enemy and not as an opposition to lead the to govern and to rule in this state. So how can we go ahead with a proper democratic model and to resort to elections in order to contain the political Islam and in a way to allow the people and the people to elect according to their will and not to go through these violent conflicts and struggles at the expense of the political and democratic thought. And this has harmed the Arab democracy and the proper methodology to allow people to elect. And we are now in the 21st century and we have the technology and we have many positive points, but we are unable to be at the level of moving ahead with the democracy the same way in India and Israel. If we consider these organizations as part of our political thinking, how can we drive them to adopt the modern visions and to make it part of the political and not to make them follow the unilateral and such trends and patterns? How can we go ahead with a proper methodology to avoid such crises and such conflicts?
I think that we should not deal with democracy as naives. You do not expect democracy to be a final treatment for your wound, and once you put it on the wound, it will recover. No. If you trace the progress of democracy, even in Britain, you'll have to go back to the history. Sometimes they refused to acknowledge the rights of all people to vote, and the gradual movement towards full democracy, and how some conditions of, for example, having a property in order to have the franchise to vote, and women were deprived of the right to vote, and then due to the influence of wars and other things and political movements and these rights, and democracy is not sufficient sometimes in dealing with different parties. You have the power or the authority, you have the people or the nation, and the education or the culture adopted by the people. These three pillars in order to reconcile with each other, in order to get integrated in the exchange of roles and ideas, you may need more analysis and intellectual contributions and seminars and conferences. And specifically, there is an economic factor that may help you to support democracy in the Arab world. And as you know, democracy, you are professors in the fields of political sciences and specialize in this field. Democracy is the weapon of politicians for the middle classes, and this class usually presents this frame to be acceptable for the whole state on gradual movement. And this framework requires people working, and of course you take taxes, and the taxes are paid back again in the service of society, and this will also be beneficial to the taxpayers. And once, when you raise the level of taxes a little bit, they would not object to this rise. They will pay with some sort of relief, although sometimes they are indignant, but their anger will be absorbed, and thus the cycle moves. We don't have such a thing. We don't have such a thing in the Arab world since the independence of many Arab countries. We have been passing through bitter stages, the totalitarian despotic state in the Arab countries, in Iraq, for example, or Libya, or other places. These countries do not only confiscate the present, but it confiscates the future also. And thus you find all these diseases, psychological diseases, whether in Libya or in Iraq, and these divisions. How could people take their own political and administrative roles? In fact, the reason was this despotic attitude, this totalitarian dictatorship that did not allow the civil society to work, to organize themselves, to gain more experience, to get maturer in dealing with politics and to solve problems. And this allowed also, they did not even allow women to take part in life, and therefore you'll find a big discrepancy, an imbalance in society. In order to for the people to be mature, they need an educated woman, an educated mother that brings up her children, a democratic family that respects her opinion, and they do not look at her as a burden in a family which has its own regulations and laws. So our problem since the beginning of our own openness to the world and to the new ideas, we've been in panting after these ideas. We are not given the chance to breathe and to take our breath in order to join this contemporary world, or to renew, or to understand our own concepts, or the concepts of the modern world or contemporary world. So you need you see changes, transformations, new ideas, and rapid movements, full transformation, complete transformation of a set of values. All this will create problems for us, and this will see that either people become indifferent, or sometimes you might see a gradual trend of dependence on the state. And this is one of the things that concern me, that in the Arab Spring nations, that people will depend 100% on the government or on the state. They will never take the responsibility as a nation. And yes, you have entered into a revolution, and you have to take the responsibility therefore. As for the comparison that you mentioned between the comparison between the Muslim Brotherhood and Turkey, or the Turkish experience in Turkey, the political Islam current is completely different there. First of all, they are close to Europe, and they had passed through a period of secular movements, and they have an army that played a very important national role in the establishment of the Turkish state. We know that Turkey, after the Second World War, Greece invaded them and almost took half of the Anatolia, and the Kemal Ataturk ousted the Greeks out of Anatolia and saved Turkey or the remains of the Ottoman Empire from disintegration. Of course, you know the history of modern Turkey, but in short, I can say that the Turkish experience has its own specific particulars, and they think of themselves as a potential member of the European Union, and that Turkey has its own strong industrial and economic infrastructures, advanced infrastructures. In fact, they have universities and research centers, and they have the freedom of research in comparison with the Arab world. So So take for example the Salafi movement or the Tahrir party or all the traditional and fundamentalist movements in the Arab world. They are not advanced to the expected level. For example, until now you read, for example, have the Muslim Brothers in Egypt criticize themselves. Did they say that this book does not represent it? All Muslim brothers read Sayyid Qutb's books in the Fidhul al-Quran, for example, the shadows, or in the shadows of the Quran, they consider this is the only interpretation of the Quran. And they have, for example, the writings of Fathi Yakin and Sa'id Hawa only. They don't read any other thing. And Muslim brothers do not have any contribution, I mean cultural contribution, to the Arab culture, modern Arab culture. And this is something that many people do not recognize, in fact. And I say, for example, has anyone of the members of the Muslim Brotherhood written a novel, for example, a winner of the Booker, or wrote a collection of poetry, for example? See how many of them were oppressed and put in jail. They could have written hundreds of novels, but there was no novel written from these experiences by any one of the religious thinkers. Poetry, for example, where are they? For example, if you take Badr Shakir Sayyab from Iraq, or Abdul Wahab Bayati from Iraq, or Adonis from Egypt, or Nizar Qabani from Syria, and all these names that you know, where are the other Muslim brothers poets? Where are they in comparison with those secularists? Give me a book in criticism, for example. Give me a dictionary in Arabic that was developed. Don't you say that the Arabic language is the language of the dwellers of paradise? Give me something like Oxford. You have millions of dollars and you have millions of Islamic houses or Islamic financial funds. You have billions of dollars. You have money to create new literary movements and creative movements. But the Muslim brothers do not think of that. They are not a kind of a renaissance movement. They have made use of a certain circumstances. Hassan al-Banna, the founder, was a politician, a man who could be described as a good organizer, but he was not a thinker. When you read his messages or his treaties, they were in fact political reports for political parties, and they are not deep intellectual analysis that goes, for example, into the characteristics of Arabic thought or the development of Islam entering in comparisons with other religions. No. This has nothing to do with Hassan al-Banna's ideas at all. And he was talking about something else, in fact. He talks about, for example, the parliament, the Egyptians, and our rivals, and what are we going to do. So up to this moment, you can feel that Sheikh Al-Kharraw, for example, nowadays has written many books, but most of them and all of them are focusing on Islamic thought and how to extend this way of thinking in the Arab world, how to spread it. Up to this moment, you go to any library, and I never miss any book fair there in Kuwait, for example. You don't feel any development in the Islamic book, for example. They see the challenges in the modern world, the contemporary world, and issue new books, for example. At the same time, see the books issued by Western countries. Go to Boston or Chicago or London and see the books, the new books about Islam there. You see the things that they deal with, see the originality of research, see the depth of analysis here. This is the problem, and some of the problems that we are facing with the religious trends in the Arab world, and this is a very dangerous matter. Culturally, they have failed. They have nothing to present, and talking about, you have been oppressed. You should have been creative. You should have been deep in the study of law and the development of law in the Arab countries. They stand against the law in the Arab countries. They say this is a positive law, has been taken from the West, and this is against Islam, and something like that. At the same time, when you read, for example, a Sheikh by Muhammad al-Ghazali, for example, Muhammad al-Ghazali says that we have a kind of poverty in law, in our legal knowledge. Many of our legislations in the field of administration are imported from the West. Okay. Hassan Turabi, for example, who is always shouting about Islam and save Islam and other things now, he says that there is kind of a decline in political jurisprudence in Islam. Okay. I don't know. There is a kind of decline. What is the reason for this decline? We are suffering from this decline. Without further ado, there are many, many details that we have to deal with. Last question, please. Last question, please. Thank you, Mr. Khalil Haidar. Please, microphone, please. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Khalil, for this important review and presentation of the history of Islamic thought and political Islam. And my name is Ahmed Al Hassani, a former ambassador. Yes, please, Ahmed Al Hassani, a former ambassador. And I see that political Islam, or the danger of political Islam nowadays, is that there are different arms that started to spread throughout the Arab countries, especially after the Arab Spring, and that is the phenomenon of violence. And very few of these movements reject the idea of violence, because most of them support it. For example, what happened in Tunisia, for example, there was a kind of what is called the drying of the sources of terror, for example, although Tunisia witnessed a kind of economic growth and openness, but the regime itself created that trend and that attitude in order to sympathize with the political Islam movement and ignoring at the same time the religious aspect. Now, what I say is that they made use of Islam as a religion, and we did not put it as our own priorities. I do remember, for example, Dr. Ramadan Bouti was invited here by the center. He said, I could solve many problems if the state gives priority to Islam as a religion. Why? Because the other Islamists present themselves as defenders of Islam, and they try to deviate from the path of Islam, and that's why you find the nations or the people or the communities sympathize with them. Now, the danger lies in the fact that there are sleeping cells sympathizing with these Islamists or jihadists, and therefore, in order to save our nation or to save our people or our countries, we have to launch a new project, especially, as you said, among the middle class, which is the safety valve. In Egypt, for example, the middle class is very weak nowadays and declining, I mean, at the political level or the economic level. This is a problem, and we have to launch a new project, a new idea to include Islam, the Islam of Prophet Muhammad, the Islam, the real Islam, because those political Islamists made use of Islam and exploited Islam. And unless we adopt Islam, for example, here, for example, in the Emirates, after what happened with the Muslim Brothers, people started to leave them, to disintegrate themselves from them. They were sympathizing with them because they used to say that we are the defenders of faith. And they said, why don't you ask people to say prayers? And even many people sympathize with them because, as Dr. Muhammad Amara said in one of his books, instead of saying that we separate politics from religion, we should distinguish religion from politics. But if you want to have a politician, we should have a person who is specialized. And if we have a clergyman who is specialized, we put him for saying the adhan for the prayer. So we have to embrace Islam, to embrace faith as a solution.
Well,
The important point in your comment, or the most important point in your speech, in my opinion, is that I believe that opposing the religious thought is not the solution of the current dilemma in the Arab and Islamic world. The problem is that there is a problem. There is an atmosphere of the lack of trust. And unfortunately, each party thinks that by deepening itself, it would gain further grounds. But opposing the Islamic movement has so many ideas on the social, economic, and ethical life. Either you discuss these ideas and then you refute such ideas, or that thought would overcome you. The problem in our culture is that the Islamists have the right to say whatever they wish and to defend their ideas. You don't have this freedom. You cannot criticize the Islamists because you will be, at the end of the day, you will be opposing the religions, and all Muslims safeguard their religion, and this is an absolute matter, and there is no way of discussing this matter. But how can you tell the Islamists the Holy Quran refers, for example, there are the verses which call for punishing because Islam at that time was new and was threatened, and the number of Muslims was little and few. But nowadays there are 1.5 billion Muslims, and there are more than 45 Islamic countries. So we must understand some of the religious texts in a better and in a new way, and in a way that gives the right of discussion at a certain level. We don't have this nowadays. And each one who publishes a small book and declares any sort of opinion would be intimidated. And Brad Hoffman is a German thinker, and he embraced Islam. Nothing happened to him, and he continued as a German diplomat. But just imagine what will happen to an Arab or Islamic diplomat if he embraces Buddhism or Christianity. He would be immediately dismissed from his position and would be persecuted legally and religiously. The mosques, for example, mosques are all over Europe, Australia, Canada, and the United States. But there is a long discussion, and even in the GCC countries and Arab countries, on building churches. And a magazine like Al Mujtama, a magazine which is published in Kuwait, and it is one of the most important magazines of Muslim Brothers, are calling to cancel and to remove all churches from Kuwait and from the Arab Peninsula. If you have such a principle which calls for driving all non-Muslims from the Arab Peninsula, can you just raise such a slogan in the 21st century? And in this situation, we should be frank to ourselves before being frank with the outside world. If you cannot reach peace with yourself and with your people, you cannot make peace with the other outside world. And because you are not making any understanding with your people, that's why Osama Osama bin Laden was succeeded in using this issue and found people that acclaim and praise him. And you don't find the religious leaders who came out with a new vision. Therefore, the prevailing thing is the what we inherited for more than 1,000 years, and the jurisprudence researches is not exerting efforts to change many ideas and many issues. Nowadays, our ability or the ability of Muslims in the 21st century to understand Islam is larger and bigger than most of those who lived before us, because we now have computers, and with a click on a button, you can get all the interpretations of the Quran and other issues. You will find the ideas and the thoughts of thousands of years. But at the old ages, one would ride a camel to travel far away to just to get some ideas. But now with the globalization, and you are in Hawaii, when you are in Alaska, you can follow a lecture being held in UAE, or while you are in the UAE, you can follow a lecture being held far away in the world. So we are before huge and new challenges that require new thinking. And this is the most important point. We conclude this lecture. I agree with you, Mr. Khalil, and we are facing a lot of challenges in the Arab region, and we have, and the problem is not our problem, is the problem is the misunderstanding of the Islamic concepts and what we inherit from before. You have assured the question, would the political Islam succeed and manage to deal with the Arab problems and dilemmas and find solutions? I think that with the failure of the experience of the political Islam in Egypt and its inability to deal with such problems in Egypt, I don't know whether this question would ascertain the failure of the political Islam or not. At the end of this lecture, we only thank our Mr. Khalil Al Haidar for his valuable information and visions on the political Islam between thought and reality, and I thank you for your attendance, and I also invite you for dinner in the center. Follow the signs to get to the buffet, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you.